It's time for Cash Plays, where we turn bustos into robustos. Brought to you by StackemCoaching.com. Rethink poker. And now, your hosts, John Kim and Joe Tihon.
Hey, what's up, guys? This is John Kim
and hey guys.
Joe Tihon, partner in crime. So,
back again.
Cash Plays, our fifth episode brought to you by StackemCoaching.com. Use promo code QuadJacks82 for a free 3-day trial. Rethink poker and take your game to a new level. All right, Joe, right off the bat, congratulations. For people that don't know, you became a daddy a couple of days ago, a few days ago.
Yeah, man, what an experience. It was Friday night we had the baby, and I've been in the hospital for a couple days, and just haven't really done much of anything other than like stare at this little baby that I made.
We've already had talks, and I shared my experiences with you. I'm a father also, with one kid, so your life's forever changed now. So bring the baby here. Go call Lisa. Let's show the world your baby. I'm sure people are.
Please bring the baby.
do you want to say what his name is?
His name's Tyler. My wife is Asian, so he kind of has a little Asian look to him. But he's adorable. Here he is.
Hi, Lisa.
Hi, baby.
There's Tyler. There's his first introduction to the world.
Hi, baby.
Are you sure you're the father? He has a lot of hair.
Oh, come on, man.
Just kidding.
Yeah. He's
cute.
He's a beauty. So, that's. I'm going to hand him off.
So
that's my little man, yeah.
So I was talking earlier, you already did the whole diaper thing, everything like that.
Yeah. You get used to it a little bit at a time, I guess. So, but it helps put poker and everything else in perspective. Bad sessions aren't quite as bad. I mean, I haven't played at all since I've had the baby, but. You know, I mean, just when my wife's pregnant and everything, and when you think about having kids and all that, it's like when you're losing, it's not never all that bad, you know, because you still got good things to go home to anyways.
Yeah, I'll share a story with you. I used to be somewhat of a degen before I got married. I think most kids, you know, early 20s, whatever, you're in the poker world, and I was playing poker, whatever, you tend to do a lot of degenerate stuff. Young, you don't know any better.
Yeah, so, I went through a long phase of that.
Yeah, I mean, we all go through that, I think, especially if you end up picking poker as your profession. It wasn't until, I want to say when I got married, I started slowly seeing responsibilities and changing my life to like a grown-up should do. But once I had my kid, that's when, you know, like, my mindset completely changed.
So. Yeah, I mean, you know, likewise. I play poker during the days now, and, you know, it's like a 9-to-5. I treat it more like a job as opposed to just playing like a total degen like I used to. I think everyone goes through a phase when they first start playing.
Yeah. Congratulations on the kid, and, you know, best of luck.
Thank you.
It's going to be a lot of restless nights coming. In the near future. But all right, let's get into poker. I wanted to really quickly share my recent experience. I've been telling you I've been running somewhat poorly online. Live I've been doing okay, but live is generally easier than online. But that's not to say I can't run bad in live. You can run bad, good in any form of poker. So whenever you run bad, I think it's a good time to take a step back and reflect on your game and try to see what things you're doing wrong. And I had a talk with an online cash game grinder, a good player, and I was just going over some stats with him. And he pointed out a couple of things in my stats I play a very loose, laggy style online, like close to 30 VPIP, PFR about 25, 26. It's pretty laggy. And I think with the games getting tougher, and pretty much, especially the sticks, I play like mid-sticks, 2-4 to 5-10. I think you do, you kind of have to tighten up in today's games because everyone's pretty strong fundamentally. So I told him my one money at Showdown is pretty low, about 46, 47% the last 2 months. Historically, it's been over 49, 50%. So I just felt like I was running into the nuts or top of the ranges of my opponents too frequently, and that was the cause of bad luck. But he pointed out, like, if I have a laggy style, you should be going to Showdown less. And I was still going to Showdown like 26, 27%, which is too high considering my laggy style, which makes sense. If you're playing a lot of hands, you're going to have a lot of crappy hands at the river. So you shouldn't be shouldn't be going to the river too often. So that kind of opened my eyes a little bit. And I pretty much told me, I mean, he was pretty much saying, like, you know, I'm going to the river too often. This is why I'm only winning 46, 47% at Showdown. So I made the adjustment of tightening up.
You know, kind of like a similar thing that you see in live poker. And I would say this to, like, a lot of people. It's like the better the players you are that you're playing against, the more that the cards matter. I mean, you know, the less you can do, you can't be as creative. You can't, you know, you can't do anything. But, you know, so when you're playing, you know, if you're in a 5 or 6 handed game against some very tough, competent opponents, you know, your cards are going to speak for themselves a lot more than they normally would.
Right, I agree. You know, like I said, and this is six max, by the way. Four rank two, I'm tightening up in all across all spectrums.
Boring.
But mostly four. Six max. So I tightened up, reduced my VPIP to about 24, 25, PFR 21, 20, about 5 percentage points in both areas. And my one money at Showdown has increased to 50, 51%, and I've actually started winning again. So, I mean, it's still only about 10,000, 20,000 hands. It's not like a big sample size. So, I mean, it could be varying. I'm running a little better, too. I mean, I was running horribly. But I think this point illustrates it's a good point. The point is, like, whenever you're running bad, it's good to take a step back and see what areas that you might be messing up on. And the game's always changing. Games are always getting tougher. And like you said, I'm playing against good players mostly all the time. You know, I think I let ego or whatever, a little bit of ego get in the way, thinking I can play garbage and outplay everybody post-flop. But you know, these games, like you said, players are good. Like, you need to show up with the goods on the river.
Exactly. So, I mean, you can only do so much. You can only do so much. But I think this is important. Especially for a lot of people that are listening to this show or whoever's listening to this show. I mean, even you you've been playing poker and you've probably played more hands of poker than, like, I mean, almost like 99.99% of poker players. I mean, you've played so many hands of poker and you're still, like, you know, 14 years later or whatever, you're still, like, questioning everything you do and still, like, always trying to make adjustments. So, you know, and I think that's important for people to realize that, like, you know, just when you think you have it figured out, I mean, because there's some sessions you quit and you're like, oh, this game's so easy, I got it all figured out, when, you know, maybe you're just running good, or even if you're running good for like a month or whatever it is, or 2 months, or, you know, you're going to go through a bad stretch where you always want to, like, you always want to think about when you are running good, you know, think about the small things.
Right. I mean, it's what you're saying is a constant learning process, and I agree with that. I mean, you and I both stress that, and we live by that that mantra, and that's helped us throughout the year. So I know you do the same way, but you never seem to lose, so you don't go through that much like I do.
I lose. Everyone else.
Yeah, sure. Since we're in the online mode, James, one of our coaches at Stack'em and a very good player in his own right.
Oh man, I was reading this hand earlier.
Okay, so
what is he doing?
No, but let's talk about this hand. He's currently in Mexico grinding Poker Stars, which is pretty nice, I guess. So this is on a full rank table, 50 NL. So it's $50 NL, and even at those stakes, there's good players, guys that are making a living. Like they say live, you just multiply it by 10 times. Online, to live stakes and get the same skill level. So even 50 and L, again, is tough. So James, our hero, is under the gun with $53. He blinds are 25¢, 50 cents. He has queen jack of diamonds. He raises to 150, gets two callers, under the gun plus one, button calls. He says under the gun plus one is a reg fish. Reg fish is different than your typical fish. A reg fish is a regular, a kind of a break even at best, maybe losing regular, lives by the rake back or whatever. So it's not like a total fish. And he said the button's like a really nitty ABC player. And the flop comes jack 5-10 with two clubs and a spade. He has jack queen jack of diamonds. There's 525 in the pot. He bets 350, gets called in both spots. There's $15 in the pot now. On the turns, a deuce of hearts, so it's a brick. He bets $11.50 into a $15.75 pot. They both call. On the river, there's $50. And James asked me what I would do on the river. You tackle it.
Well, the river paired the deuce. It was an offsuit deuce. Yeah. So it
came deuce, word, no flush.
Yeah. Jack 10, 5, two clubs, turn deuce, river deuce. No flush got there, anything. And he led the betting the whole way, which is good. I like that. When you have top pair out of position in a spot like that, I think it's always good just to keep your foot on the gas, just kind of bet to protect your hand. You just don't want to get into check call mode in those spots because you're always guessing. So when you lead the action, you're kind of keeping control of the pot and also you're charging them for their draws. So I think he played it properly on the flop and turn, and then he asks, where'd he say?
On the river.
He said, yeah, okay. But the conversation was unbelievable.
Okay, well, all right. Well, what are your thoughts on the river, first of all, before we get into the conversation?
So there's $50 in the pot, right? And
we have like 35 left.
I didn't realize the stack sizes, I guess. I guess it's not. But still, like, in that spot, I think it's always best to just check. And, I mean, there aren't too many worse hands that are going to pay you off there. A hand like Ace 10 or King 10 is probably just going to fold on the turn, I would think.
They're folding on the river for sure.
I don't think you're getting too much value from worse hands. So.
Yeah, we're not ever betting for value here. Yeah, like I said, so the standard play, when I saw the hand, I'm like, okay, this is such a standard hand. Like, just check, evaluate the river. Maybe check call sometimes, check fold sometimes, depending on bet sizing and whoever bets. So is that your answer, just to check?
I would definitely. Well, here's the thing: when you have a hand like top pair, and you're thinking, I mean, when you're deciding whether or not to bet the river, it's like which hands are going to call me, and in that spot, there's not too many. I mean, most jacks. I mean, I guess the guy could have jack nine suited, and you lose out on like $30 in value. But I think overall,
you can't ever bet for value.
But I mean, no way would I be betting for as a bluff. Like,
okay, that's where the conversation headed down the path.
I mean,
as he said, what about shoving the river as a bluff? Initially, I was like, I don't know. I think you're gonna get called by ace jack, queens, kings,
king jack. I mean, any jack's gonna call you. The only thing I would be thinking about by not shoving the river is like, oh, I might be missing value from some worse hands. But I would never be thinking, oh, I'm going to turn my hand into a bluff because I'm going to fold out better. Like, who's really ever going to fold better there? Like, no one's ever folding ace jack, I don't think, or any overpairs or any, like, I think it's unlikely that they have flopped sets or anything. So
yeah, they're unlikely to have aces or kings though, because they just flatted pretty. The only hands you're worried about is queens, ace jack, king jack. Those are like the only three hands. And he said he likes shoving the river as a bluff,
which I think is horrible.
I don't. The more I thought about it, the more I thought it wasn't that bad. To be honest,
that's horrible.
No, here's why. This is what he's thinking.
It is so wrong.
His thinking is if he shoves a river into two players, I mean, I'm not saying it's correct. I'm still thinking about it, but
Okay,
he's
yeah,
saying
it
if he
looks a
shoves into
little
two
bit.
players, it looks like he has ace jack minimum there, like always. Put yourself in the other two players' shoes if you have king jack or ace jack. The middle guy can't call with the guy behind him. He almost really can't call.
Of course he
The
can.
guy.
The guy behind him never has a better made hand. The guy behind him always has a draw.
Okay,
Like,
well, yeah, he could call, but he's not calling king jack, I don't think. Maybe he is, but I don't think so. Ace jack is questionable, and queens is like the only other hand he could have. Kings and aces are probably three betting pre. But I do think it's probably a check because there's only two, three value hands that you're trying to bluff is queens, ace jack, king jack. That's pretty much it.
and
Everything
they're
else.
still gonna call. I think they're calling with, like, I mean, this is maybe it's because I play too much live poker and you play too much online. That's the difference. But like, this seems like a no-brainer spot, and I think you're always getting called by better hands, always.
Okay.
I don't think you're ever folding out better hands. So
Yeah, I actually agree you shouldn't shove. The more I don't know what I said my ultimate decision was, but I thought it was just closer than what you're saying. Just because like he said, like if you fire into two people, you have to have it. And he just but the problem with that is you're just assuming they're thinking at your level, and sometimes they don't think that way. So they just see their hand ace jack or queens and like, okay, you might have
Yeah,
ace
they
king or
just
queen.
call. That's what I would do. I'd be like, oh, I don't know what the hell this guy's got, but I'm calling. Like, I have ace jack, right? I
Yeah,
mean,
right. So, but it brings up an interesting concept of turning like pretty good made hands into bluffs, things like that. I don't think people utilize it enough. I think live you don't have to because you just exploit players by the mistakes they make. And when you're turning made hands into bluffs, you're trying to outplay them, and that's you don't really have to do that to like win a ton of money live. But online, again, where edges are smaller, sometimes you have to do that. And this is why James is thinking on this level. So, and speaking of, turning made hands into bluffs, or I wanted to bring up this hand, I kind of noted down. Or.
And also another point real quick with this hand. I mean, the board was Jack 10 5 with two clubs.
And it
And now
came
goes
running deuces
bet
with no.
call, do yeah, running deuces, totally safe run out. A by shoving, you're not allowing them to bluff with hands like
King
King
Queen.
Queen or 8-9 or missed flush draws, like millions of hands that you have beat that you wanna, some people are just gonna. You know,
Right.
it's like
So,
they're
yeah.
thinking,
So,
oh, it's three-way action. It's less likely that I'm bluffing into two people. So,
yeah. So there's a lot more value in turning it into a bluff catcher than turning it into a bluff. I
and
agree
I
with you.
think it's like check call always. Like I would pretty much always check call the river.
I agree with you. I only say that it might be closer because I always try to think about all the different options. Even and this one and like shoving as a bluff is definitely thinking outside the box. It always seems cool to like kind of do something like
Yeah,
that
it seems
on
cool, but I mean, I thought about it too, but
the
it's just in that spot, it's kind of, I don't see what you're bluffing out, so I don't think it's.
So, along the same lines of turning hands into bluffs or avoiding chops, I mean, it's a little different, but I was playing 5-10 with one of my students the other day at Bellagio, and
Okay.
two limpers, and I raised 260 with queen nine of clubs. And I don't think enough people take this line that I'm about to take in live. Online players do it, but this is a good example. I get three callers, I'm in position, the flop comes queen, deuce, five, rainbow. It's like a whatever flop for me. Because if I get called, then I'm like, I could be beat by a better queen. But anyways, they all check to me and I bet half pot. It's a pretty dry flop. So there's like 240. I probably no, there's I got two callers actually, limper and a small blind. And there's so I bet like I think I bet like 80. There's probably 160 in the pot. I'm trying to I might be a
This
little off.
sounds like it was probably a cool overbet spot.
Okay, yeah, that's where it's headed. And small balls, turns an offsuit ace, he checks, and I kind of thought of just like three barreling trying to get him off a queen, but because the ace is good for my range, but I just whatever, I'm just going to try to get the shield down and hope queen nine wins. I check it back, river pairs the deuce, and obviously, I mean, I know what you're going to say, you should bomb the river. I mean, he checks, and I think this is a spot where most people just check it back and are content to like win with a queen with an ace kicker. But I think you should always bomb the river here because you're pretty much free rolling. I think it's a great run out for my hand. Because
Real quickly, like unless he has a hand like ace three or ace four, like some sort of some sort of wheel draw, like he most likely doesn't have an ace. And if he did have ace three or ace four, he's probably gonna bet the river. So when you say you're on a free roll, like that's what you mean. Like the best he can have is probably the other queen.
Exactly. He has king, queen, or queen jack. He never has queen deuce or queen five or a set. And again, if he had like the hands you said, ace three, ace four, he's probably going to value bet like half pot on the river, try to get paid off by my queen or kings or whatever. Yeah. So, and he checks the river, and I think there was about 300 in the pot, and I bet like, I think I bet too small to be honest. I bet 320. A little over a pot, just thinking, oh, he can't call with the queen. But I wish I bet like 400 something.
Because yeah, you can bet like 550 or something, or 600.
Exactly. I knew that right away after I bet it. I'm like, even though I overpotted it by a little bit, it's still too small because I'm always free rolling here. Like, so I'm like, damn it, if he calls, I'm gonna be mad at myself because I just bet too small. This is a spot where we're always gonna chop. Like when he calls, and he's almost never beating me. So, but my point is, most people are just content checking it back here and chopping the pot, and the other guy shows king, queen, or queen jack, or whatever.
Yeah, I agree. And these are spots like that. Most good, you know, there's a lot of good players who don't even consider these things. I mean, there's a lot of people that are like, "Oh, this guy's really good," but you know, there's small things like this that some people just don't even consider. You know, you'll see it a lot more when the flop's like. You know, if the flop comes like ace XX and somehow the board pairs and there's the board's ace king like five deuce deuce or something, and you just have the naked ace and you know the other guy has the ace, you know, and you know that's all they have is just the ace. There's you know, a lot of times you're just free rolling on a bet there.
All right, here's a spot I played online, same along the same lines. Guy raises, I call with ace five suited, and the flop comes ace deuce three. He bets, I call, turns a four. He checks, I bet. He calls, I turn the wheel. River's a five, so I'm, you know, whatever. He checks, and I think he raised under the gun, so I don't. He doesn't have really any sixes in his range, so he has like big aces, might have flop sets or whatever. So I just bombed the river like 1.5 times pot because he can't call that profitably. And so, and I don't want him to call. For a chop either. So even though, like most people, their reaction be like, you know,
they're like,
damn
oh,
it.
What a river.
Yeah, what a river. Now we have to chop. I already had the straight. I check it. This is messed up. No, you should be thinking along the lines of, does he have sixes in his range? Probably not, and not in the spot. So just, you can still win it outright. So, you know, I bombed the river like close to 1.5 times pot. Just a number where I know he can't call profitably. Even a pot size bet, he'll probably fold, but I just wanted to make sure because I was pretty sure he'd never had any sixes in his range. And even if he has six, I think he's more likely to lead, trying to get paid off by me playing the board also.
Yeah, exactly.
So those spots, people just are content to chop the pot. You see it all the time in live too. Like they just check it back and like, oh, I play the board now, blah, blah, blah. But if they, a lot of spots, they're missing out value and just like scooping the pot. So
yeah, I mean, and I think maybe next week we'll talk about some like, you know, really interesting overbetting situations.
Oh yeah, you're good at that. I know when we cans, you're always saying you're two times potting on the turns.
I mean,
pretty cool.
Yeah, but I think this is a really good point that you bring up, and it's a small change that people can make. To their game, and I mean, even if these things work out like once or twice, I mean, if you never even consider doing them before and you just make these adjustments like once or twice, it's gonna, you know, I mean, whatever it is, it could win you like a few hundred dollars, or even if you do end up getting called, you're like, oh wow, at least I made the, you know, that was a smart bluff. Like I learned something here, you know.
Yeah, I want to address this comment in the chat box, Mr. Face Suited. I love how they seriously overthink fairly simple hands. Maybe they have to dumb it down. I don't know.
Oh man.
Yeah, I mean sometimes. No, it's just I think it's fine. But You know, that's just the nature of you, like players like us, Joe, which is fine. We're trying to think of every angle of like every situation. And this is how you get good at poker and come to the best EV decision. Even the simple stuff on surface could be a lot more complicated. And then, like I said, a lot of these chop spots seems like obvious chop spots. But in reality, if you look deeper, I mean, you can gain equity, you can gain, you know, spots where you can win pots that it looks very obvious in surface. I know
you
wasn't
hear
being...
all these like really cool, sophisticated, interesting hands, but like
I'm not taking it as an insult at all. I just think it's good nature stuff. So don't worry, Mr. Face Suited. We're not offended or anything. But I like the fact brings up a good point. I like the fact, you know, a lot of hands seem simple when in reality, actually they're not. And I think you want to get to a point where even the simplest looking hands have a lot of depth to them. And you can see that, then I think you're well on your way to like.
I mean, that's the thing with poker, though, but you're not always going to hear these crazy, like, awesome hands. You're just going to hear like basic hands that everyone plays. But it's like, what are the little things I can be doing to like increase my profit in these games? Like, and these are like small spots that are going to work out, I think.
Right. I mean, I tend to ramble on. I can talk about like projects. Saying Zach is saying I can talk about a hand, one specific hand, for an hour straight. So, and I've done that, and you've had to cut me off and kind of get me to move on to the next hand. So
yeah.
But anyway, let's go on to the next thing. I want to answer a listener email. He said he's a big fan of the show. Thanks us. He's watched all the shows so far. He's from Southern California, your region. He plays low levels in most LA spots, Commerce, Bike, playing 1-2 no limit tables. He calls them $40 tables because the buy-in is $40-$60. So his name is Rob, and he wants to know, his question is, how relevant is table image? Is table image important to this game and himself? And he goes on to say, the other day you were telling Jameson to remain patient, even though he's getting frustrated with bad cards. I'm really good at being patient. These are his words. I'm really good at being patient when cards are cold, except after a while it hurts my table image and can't get much action when entering a pot. How can I maintain a good table image without sacrificing my patience and bankroll? Again, he's playing 1-2 with $40 to $60 buy-in stakes. What's your answer to that, Joe?
I mean, my answer to all this is like, table image just does not matter. I mean, it just does not matter. Like, especially when you're playing like 40 big blinds deep or 20 big blinds deep or whatever the buy-in is.
20 to 30 big blinds deep. So it's almost like a tournament thing. Almost seems like you need to have a tournament mindset.
Yeah, like, I mean,
I know your position, Joe. You've always reiterated that image is overrated.
It's way overrated.
It's more about the fundamentals and specifics of a hand at the moment. But I do think there's some value in image. But I think it's more based on how you capitalize on image. It's based on pretty much your VPIP, live or online, the cards you've played, the number of hands you've played up to that point. And I don't think you should try to like establish a set image. I think you should let the way the session is going kind of determine how your image is and play off of that. So if you've been getting a lot of good hands and playing a lot of hands, it'll look like you have a loose, laggy image, and play off that and realize players think that way. If you've been carded for 2 hours, people are going to think you're a big nit and just play off that, bluff more, stuff like that. But with that said, in this particular game, a $40 to $60 buy-in at 1-2, 20 to 30 buy-ins. I mean, I've dabbled in cap games online where you buy in for 20 BBs or 40 BBs. It's just a math-based game. There really isn't that much leveling wars. I think, Rob, you need to understand the mathematics of the game like this. Just knowing, like, even you can go get a tournament chart, like shoving, reshoving, hand ranges, stuff like that with 20 to 30 BBs, because that's essentially what you're playing with and what everyone has. So a lot of your decisions are going to be math-based more than image-based in this particular game. So that's what I would say. Right. So that's pretty much like tournament stuff. You also have to be aware of stack-to-pot ratio, SPR, because at these stakes, I guess there's a way to manipulate pre-flop action, min-raising, stuff like that to get the SPR you want, which allows better decisions
post-flop. No, I mean, yeah, when I do say that image never really matters, although, you know, I do, you know, I play my cards. I'll play the cards I get dealt. Sometimes I'm getting dealt nothing and I'm folding every hand, and other times I'm getting dealt a lot of premium hands. And yeah, if you do get dealt premium hands and you are playing a lot of hands, you know, subconsciously you're going to know that, hey, these guys, they've seen me play a lot of hands. They think I'm loose. You know, it makes subtle differences, but I don't think it's, I think people worry about image entirely too much.
Yeah, as for somebody asked, how do you go about getting a chart or making up a chart with 20, 30 BB stacks? They might actually even have them online if you Google it, but you can always download Poker Stove or a few other programs and just kind of go through examples of putting in like your hand versus a range of hands with 20 BB and just see how the equities make up, and you realize if you're plus EV or not, if you shove, reshove with 20 to 30 BB stacks. A lot of it is just math-based, and you just have to do your homework when it comes to it. So.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, Joe, I know you have to go early, being a new father and all. So we're going to bring on Nick Davila. He was on before a couple of weeks ago. He's going to fill in for Joe. And then we're going to also bring on Dave Tannenholtz. I hope I'm saying his last name correctly. And we're going to talk more about strategy right after this. So take care, Joe.
Enjoy. Right. See you later.
Bye.
And now your hosts, John Kim and Joe Tihan.
All right, we're back, and we're going to have Nick Davila subbing in for Joe, because Joe had to leave early because of his newborn, the joys of fatherhood. What's going on, Nick?
What's going on, John?
Okay, and Nick was on before. He's a coach over at Stack'em and a live game crusher. If you guys listened to a previous show we had a couple of weeks ago, if not, you can always check that one out. It was pretty good. Nick's here to offer his insight. And today we have Dave Tannenholtz. Am I saying that right, Dave?
Yeah, you got it.
Okay, we had a little technical problem, so we couldn't get his handsome mugshot on air on live. So we do have an image of you, so I guess that'll work for today. And I just want to ask Nick and Dave. Nick and Dave have a relationship. And Dave, you actually taught Nick or mentored Nick, is that correct?
Yeah, I'm more mentored. A while back, I guess, was that five or so years ago, started playing.
Yeah, when I was 17, 18, so yeah, almost 6 years now.
Wait, how are you playing when you're 17, 18 years old?
There were some underground games back in Pittsburgh that we would travel to, and that's just how me and Dave met, and that's actually how I met my girlfriend, too. But what the thing that got us going was I would bring in questions from the Donkey Test. It was donkeytest.com. Did I ever have you take that?
Yep, and I had like the highest score amongst us, all of us.
Oh, yeah, did you?
137 or something.
I think you beat me by like a point, but all right.
No, it was, yeah, maybe at least more
what
than
what was my score, than, Nick?
It was around the same numbers. Okay. I had like a 112, and then I took it like 3 years later, and I was around like a 130.
I think so. I got a 136 or 137. Yeah. For those that don't know, it's www.donkeytest.com. Is that the site?
Yeah, and just give me your email and you can get it, or you can pay for it for like more information.
It's just a questionnaire, 30 questions or so?
50 something.
Okay, multiple choice, bunch of hand history questions. It's like a poker's version of the SAT, I guess, but it's a little outdated. It was 2-3 years ago. The game has changed a little bit, but I still think, the score will be somewhat reflective of your poker knowledge, so it's a decent test. I know there's a couple of new tests that have come out. I can't remember it offhand. I remember seeing it on 2+2. So, so how valuable was it to have some type of mentor or someone you can look up to ask questions? In your case, Nick with Dave.
I mean, really, if I didn't have somebody better than me to talk to, like, I really don't know where I'd be. I mean, me and Dave have talked 5 days a week for the past 6 years. Just about
really?
Poker,
yeah, that's so. You guys, I think you mentioned it to me before. So you have like a similar relationship that I had with Joe. I mean, we've been friends for a few years and we've always talked poker like all the time. And we like to feel we've contributed to each other's success. So, Dave, I'd like to get a little more information on your background. Like, how long have you been playing? Is this your profession?
I've been playing. I started playing my junior year of college, which was, I guess, about 9 years ago. Just mainly online at that point, and played my junior, senior year. And after I graduated, decided to take some time off and, you know, see if it was something I could pursue. And that was 2005, I guess. Yeah, 2005, and I've been playing playing ever since. So
You were a prop too.
Yeah, yeah, I played. I had yeah, I was playing on it was a Party Poker affiliate, Empire Poker. I had a sponsorship deal with them.
What's a prop for those that don't know?
It was basically it was like a, you know, like a semi sponsorship type of deal. I mean, basically, I was getting paid to play on their site, and you know, as far as getting bought into a lot of free tournaments, and getting basically paid hourly to play on their site. And just,
I've always known props to be guys that are pretty much table starters. You had to sit on shorthanded tables and get the games going. Is that what your job was mainly?
No, it was more. It was closer to like a sponsorship deal with them.
Oh, really? So like, yeah, more of a, like a full tilt red pro?
Yeah, kind of along those lines.
Okay, because I know, I mean, there are props, live props for casinos, poker rooms around the country. They basically pay you to help start games, and then once the game fills out, you have to leave the table.
Right, like shills or whatever.
Oh, right, shills, that's another term. So, okay, so you got your start as a prop. I don't even know how you can go about filing an application for one of those things, because I would have happily did that. Get paid for playing.
at that point, they just kind of, I think, I was probably one of the biggest winners at that. At that time, that was when like one, I think like 1-2 or maybe 2-4 no limit was the highest game on Party Poker.
On Party Poker, right? I remember those days.
And
okay, so yeah.
So I was pretty much crushing those games at that point. I think they just kind of took some of the players who were regulars on there and kind of wanted to have their faces in front of the company or whatever.
Okay, I don't know why they never came to me, huh? okay, so you kind of have a similar background like me. We internet background, I played on Party Poker too, so you've been around quite a while. What do you contribute as the most to your long-term success? Because you said you've been playing, what, close to 9 years now?
Yeah, 9 years.
Nick's still like a baby. He's been doing it for 2-3 years, so.
yeah, I think just a lot of the same things that... Well, I think basically, you know, if you look at Nick and what he's doing, it's a lot of the same stuff that, you know, we've talked about for years, is just treating it like a business and, you know, being smart about it. You know, we've always kind of stressed being overrolled, not really going and taking a lot of chances in games that are way above your bankroll where variance can really, you know, knock you out of the game.
Yeah, it's interesting how we're all cash game players primarily. I mean, I dabble in more tournaments than you guys do, but we all treat it as a business and we try to take as much gamble out of poker as we can. And while tournament players, pretty much they always have to gamble because there's so much short-term variance or whatever. So I know we share like all the same mental approach to the game. So I think, you know, there's a lot of value in that. Obviously, we're going about it the right way. So for those people that want long-term success, definitely treat it like a business. Do you have any other questions for Dave, Nick, that you want to ask right now? I mean, you know him better than I do.
Yeah, off the top of my head, I think I've asked
him. So you're quick. Playing in the game. You reside in Pittsburgh right now, Dave?
Yeah, right now I am. I'm
okay,
back.
And, well, and you played in Vegas. What made you move back to Pittsburgh?
I came back east, basically just some family and personal things to take care of, and kind of be a little closer to family for the time being.
I'm trying my hardest to get his ass back out here.
Yeah, I mean, I want to. It's not that it, but yeah, so when I came back here, it was, I actually took about almost a year off from playing, where I basically wasn't really playing, wasn't really doing anything, just kind of taking care of some of that stuff back here, and then started playing up again back here in Pittsburgh, but the games weren't really all that superb. So I'm playing mostly down in Charlestown, West Virginia. It's actually outside the D.C. Baltimore area now. Much more action, much busier place. So I'm playing there mostly at this point.
Are you playing in private clubs or casinos, poker
rooms
out there?
Yeah, casino, Hollywood Casino.
Oh, okay. So. All right. All right. Well, let's get into some hands and discussion about poker, since we have two experts on hand. And then we also have Nick here, too. So... I want to talk about this forum hand. I didn't really get to chime in. I know you guys chimed in our forum over at Stack'em. And I don't know if I mentioned this, but Dave is a coach over there too, as is Nick. It was okay. I'll just read the hand. It's 75-year-old villain sitting with $400 and dozes off between hands. I'm just gonna read it word for word. I just thought it was funny. He's under the gun. He opens to 15. This is 1-2, I believe.
Yes.
Or is it 2-5? I'm not sure.
It's six. Almost positive. It's 1-2.
Okay, so he opens to 15. That's a pretty big raise at 1-2. But whatever, it can vary at 1-2. Middle position, short stack with $50, calls 15. Hero with $350 in the cutoff, calls 15 with two red sixes. Everyone else folds. They take the flop three-handed. There's $48 in the pot. The flop comes ace, 5-6, two clubs, and a spade. So our hero flops middle set. Under the gun leads for 20. Short stack throws in the remaining 35. And his question is, what do we do? And if we're raising, what's our raise size? I'd like to ask you first, Dave.
Well, I wouldn't even be thinking about raise size at this point. I think flatting's probably the best. I think raising, they're putting in an extra raise. I mean, you're really kind of chasing out a lot of the hands you're going to get value from the original raiser. I mean, he's obviously going to, you're going to get it all in if he's got aces, but if he has ace king, ace queen type hands, I mean, I don't know how often this guy is going to be willing to put it all in with ace king. And I think, you flat there, maybe he puts you on a club draw, weaker ace, and you're going to get him to call that and probably get him to lead again on the turn.
Okay. And you agree, Nick?
I agree. I mean, we shouldn't be worried about a club peeling off and killing our action. I mean, our club might kill our action, but I think raising the flop kills our action anyway, so we have to take that chance, letting a card peel off and hopefully pick up a few bets later on.
I advocate flatting too. The reason being, once the short stack moves all in for 35, we're almost like 3-betting on the flop if we re-raise. That just looks so strong in villain's eyes. And the other thing is we're in position. I always tell everyone, just play more in position. Play more streets in position. Take advantage of it. So out of position, I probably check raise. But in position, I definitely like just flatting here for all the reasons you guys mentioned. There are various posters that said raise or whatever. But
yeah, they just don't think they're going to fold top pair, top kicker. But, I mean, why take the chance?
I think a lot of inexperienced players tend to raise here too often because they think, oh, I flopped the set, I'm raising. There's a flush draw. I'm raising. I have a big hand. I want to either protect my hand, or I don't. I want to protect my hand because I have a set, or I don't know. That's probably it. I just want get it in right now while I have a set. I don't want a bad card roll off. But I always say, like, you got to think in terms of EV, what produces the most EV over the long run. So I think if you raise 3-bet here, pretty much you're 3-betting. It's just going to fold out a bunch of weaker hands.
And just a board that came to mind. Let's say we have pocket eights on a 10-9-8-2 club board. There, okay. I advocate raising. Agree?
Yeah, it's much wetter. There's a lot more bad cards that can peel off on the turn. Yeah, the wetter the flop is, the more inclined you should be raising, just because cards can kill your action, plus they have more equity against your hand, given how many outs are, how many cards can kill your hand also. But another reason why I bring up this hand, I wanted to cover this, ask your guys' thoughts on it, is one guy suggested pretending to accidentally min-raise and then giving the dumb speech of like, oh, I just meant to call. I guess it's raise because I only meant to call. What are your thoughts on pulling, I guess it's essentially an angle?
I'm not a big fan of that. I think if you want to...
You're just a little fan of it?
No, I'm thinking like of other ways that I could do it. Maybe like... put my cards in front of, closer to the line that I'm going to fold, or maybe look not interested, or just shake my head. But I think throwing in chips and you knowing it's a raise when you wanted to call or however it went, I think that's an angle.
Yeah, there's a difference, between angling and acting. And I think acting is bad enough as it is. and angling is just really taken to a whole different level. I mean, you just you know, it's, you don't need to do that, and it's, you know, it doesn't do any good for you or any good for the game, really. I mean, you can pause and take your time and him and haw about it, and then finally just call if you want. I mean, you know, you can do the old acting, the Oscar performance, but as far as the angle shooting goes, it's, I mean, you start getting used to doing that, and you know, no one's going to want to play with you. It's going to ruin the game you're playing in as it is, because everyone's going to be pretty annoyed, pretty mad by it.
Yeah, I agree. I think Dave was spot on about it. There's a huge difference between actually angle shooting and acting. You can act weak when you're strong, act strong when you're weak. That's all part of the game, whatever, that's fine. But once, yeah, if you're pretending, if you throw out a razor and pretend that you just meant to call, I mean, it's definitely an angle shooting or whatever. I see that in tournaments all the time, too. People do it for various reasons. So, and I think it's pretty telling on how you are as a person as well. I mean, whatever, we're not there to make friends on the poker table, but still, you know, I don't think there's anything, you know, there's any place for that in the game of poker. So, and most people are not there to make a living grinding. They're there for entertainment, maybe win a little bit, have fun. So you're taking a lot of fun away when you do angle shoot like that. So I would never pull something like that. I might have done it by accident, like throwing some odd chips. I think we've all done it, especially in tournament, throwing the wrong denominations, and they said, well, now it stands, whatever. But it's always by accident. It was never intentional. And if you're always doing it intentionally, I think, I mean, I would almost classify you as a scumbag of sorts, because you're basically angle shooting. So we all agree that's not good
in
the game.
Yeah.
Okay. So, and I know we're talking about that 1-2 hand earlier. The guy was asking about $40-$60 stacks, but I wanna. Well, we all needed to start off somewhere. And 1-2 is like the most commonly spread game across the states. So I want to know what your guys' input on, like, just what advice you'd give out to people that play 1-2 often, and just the kind of the mindset to have and things that you can do to improve their 1-2 game.
Dumb it down. We've said it many times somebody, on this show.
Well,
and
somebody said that earlier. Yeah. someone said that in chat, that John, I need to dumb it down.
I mean, that's really what it is. I mean, these people are playing their cards, and there's, you know, if we think that we're going to check raise turn, triple barrel, river, or whatever, all this poker talk, like, they don't understand that. So while we think it should work, it doesn't in these games, because they see top pair and they're just going to call you down. So, and that's the other thing, don't bluff. They say, yeah, bet when you have it, check when you don't.
Yeah, I agree. I know it's something that JK, you and I have, you know, said a lot of times, is fancy play syndrome is probably the biggest, you know, the biggest problem for players who have an advantage in games like 1-2, 2-5. I mean, you're probably losing a lot of value in the long run by trying to play hands fancy. I mean, the most straightforward, correct approach is usually the best in these games. You know, like, just with image and everything. I mean, the majority of people in these games are looking at their two cards, and that's really it. They have top pair, they're going to call. You know, if they don't, they're probably folding. I mean, trying to, you know, playing a hand with the idea of, like Nick's saying, check raising the turn to rep this hand. I mean, you can rep that hand all day, and to you it's going to look like that, but to the majority of players there, it's not going to. They're not going to understand that. They're not going to be looking for that. So it's basically just as straightforward as can be is really the way to go.
Yeah. What do you think the biggest leaks or mistakes 1-2 players make? I have my answer.
We can run off a couple of them. Go ahead, Dave,
okay,
you're first.
Well,
The biggest ones are probably strictly mathematical. I mean, as far as probably chase flushes and open-ended straights too much when for too big of an amounts when there's, you know, really no value in doing it. I think those are probably some of the biggest ones.
Yeah, off the top of my head, I don't know if I can pinpoint one, but watching too much TV, bluffing, bankroll management, game selection. I mean, I can name like 20 of them. I don't know if I'd pick one specific one to be the most.
So you're talking about... Yeah, like the macro point of view. I'm talking about like micro, like in-game stuff, Nick. I mean, I know what you're saying, but I would say, Dave is right about calling too much, not understanding the math. So, but I would also say not value betting enough. I think 1-2 players, they check the river way too often. You see it all the time. You see it with aces or kings where river's like an offsuit deuce, like a total brick. They check it back because they're content to win the pot. Or even hands like king-queen on a queen-high board where you know the guy might have ace-queen, but most likely he has a worse queen, and you should always be value betting there. And you see that all the time. I think people are just checking back way too often on the river when they should be getting that street of value there also. So basically, yeah, people bet two streets, but not enough three street for value. And obviously calling way too much and limping way too much. One thing that differentiates live, especially at the lower stakes versus higher stakes, is the massive amount of limping going on. How do you guys combat that, or the adjustments you make or approach that, dealing with all the limpers?
I think, for the most part, I will try to, I think Nick, you know, you're kind of the same way, we talked about these things. I mean, I would try to basically, if I'm coming in with a reasonably playable hand, you know, suited connectors, pocket pair, anything, not so much in, if we're playing like, you know, a really short game, but in a normal, you know, 100 VB or more game, I'm pretty much going to open any pot that I'm coming into. Be the aggressor, you know, hope to maybe, you know, if you're in middle, you know, raise and maybe, you know, buy the button and play against the other limpers in position. I think that's the best, probably one of the better things. I mean, because like you said, you get so many people limping and, you know, you start limping hands like 7-6 suited, you know, if you're the third one, you know, say you get two limpers in front of you and you limp 7-6 suited, which, you know, obviously is a hand you want to play, but now you're going to be up against hands like King Deuce suited and Jack Three suited, and even you're going to make your flushes a lot of times, and you're not having no idea where you're at in the hands. You're not be able to define hands at all, and I think that's probably the best way to combat that.
How about you, Nick? Agree with Dave?
Yeah, I agree. More just play good cards in position and punish the limpers, but.
That's what I was going to say. If you didn't say it, I was going to say that. I was just going to say, I only have one thing to say, and that's to punish the damn limpers. And so I guess I'm having a little bit of audio problems, but whatever. Yeah, punish the limpers like you guys are suggesting. I mean, I've seen, you know, like I've kind of dabbled in 1-2, whatever. People are limping in the crap all the time. I mean, they're limping in the king deuce off, 4-10 suited. You need to punish those guys, especially if you're in position. So, but we're running out of time. I want to ask you guys, I think we covered 1-2. Okay, now I want to ask you guys, we're going from one extreme to the other. A friend played a 10-20-40 no limit hand the other day, and he came up to me and asked me about it. So I want to see what your guys' thoughts on this. So we're going from the very basic level to a very advanced level of thinking. Okay, so he was shot taking. He's normally a 5-10 player. They're playing four-handed. There's a massive well on the game. He bought in for 4K, so 100 BBs. He opens to 120 on the button with 2-7s. A very good player, a reg. 3 bets to 360 out of the small blind. He has pocket 7s. I think you can go either or with this. You can, all options are viable. Probably folding is weak because 4-handed 7 is pretty strong. But I think you can make a case for flatting or 3 or 4 betting and getting it all in for 100 BBs.
And not a big fan of 4 betting against a good player. And I think it's strong enough for him.
I would
to
actually
call
said
in position.
I would tend to flat here, but I would advocate 4 betting more so against a good player whose 3 betting range is much wider in this spot. So I'm a little against that.
I guess it depends on dynamics.
Yeah, it depends on the frequency, dynamics, stuff like that. But anyways, he flats. I'll get to the heart of the problem later. The flop comes 10-4-3, 2 clubs. I don't know if he had the 7 of clubs. It's kind of irrelevant. The guy bets, so there's about 800 in the pot. The guy bets 600-700. He calls, turns a jack of club. It goes check, check. River pairs a jack. The guy pretty much puts my friend all in for like 3K into like a 2K pot, a little over 3K shove. He said it was close to a 2 times pot shove, maybe like a 1.8 pot shove. So what do we do with sevens there? The board is 3-4-10, jack-jack, 3 clubs.
I don't know if you can see my face. I'm not very happy about
it. Yeah,
yeah, none of us are going to be happy on the river. It's just a gross spot. I don't know if this will affect your line of thinking, but he said he knew that the kid knew that he was shot-taking. The kid's like a regular at these stakes. But my friend like the kid knew my friend was shot taken.
Do you have a quarter in your back pocket?
So you're saying it's a 50-50 spot.
Well, I just rather not make the decision on my own.
Is that what you do when you face tough spots, Nick? You
just leave it up to the coin.
And just flip it?
Well, something like that. I probably lean more towards folding. But I want your guys' opinion first.
Oh, man. This is for me, and I know, you know, I've always talked about this, Nick, a lot. I really rely a lot on physical reads, especially in these situations. And
let's say he's not giving off any read.
Feel out of context, you know, playing with a person and having an idea. Like we're talking about, when you're at lower stakes and someone bets two times pot, it's always the nuts, you know.
Right.
Forget about it. But now we're talking about that different dynamic. You move up, and a lot of times you're going to see, you know, like you said, if he knows that I'm a player who's taking, I'm not regularly there, I'm taking a shot. It's a bet that you can make a lot of times. He obviously knows you're never going to have a jack in your hand, and he knows it's going to be a tough call for you without that jack. So now he's basically putting you to the test. And I think I might actually lean more towards calling there than folding.
Is there any more info on this player?
He's like one of the best players at 10-20 plus. Very good, like a big winner. It becomes like a leveling war at these stakes. That's why I thought I'd ask you. I always find these spots interesting. That's why it makes poker tough. I mean, I feel like I know a ton, but sometimes you get in these spots where you just don't
know. Do you ever see him showing up with like a 7 off here? Like, oh, you got me. Nice call.
I don't know. I mean,
I just like
a
never
very
happens.
Good player is going to have a wide range here. I'll say that. Yeah. They should have a wide range because that's why they're a very good player. They're always putting you on your heels.
Right. And I think that, you know, while he definitely could be, you know, is obviously good enough to make, you know, this play, you know, basically a 2x pot play for value. I think more times than not, I mean, if knowing that you're a player that's taken a shot, you're playing much bigger than you're used to. If he has a value type hand, you know, if he has aces, if he has kings, if he has, you know, something along those lines, he might really try to make it easier for you to call.
Yeah, I mean, we can break down the hand ranges. Villain knows our hero doesn't have flushes, trips, full houses in his range. So that's why Villain's bluffing range is going to be wider, just because he knows hero's range, value range is very narrow. But with that said, initially I told my friend I'd probably call because I might be giving a little too much weight on the fact that he knows you're shot taking and you could be scared money for that much. But I'm not sure, but given like the actual hand, and I was talking with Joe about this hand also, and he brings up a good point, is that he said he would fold because the kid that shoves the river, like his value range is, even though it's narrow, and like that's a reason to call when their value range is narrow, but he knows that you know that, so therefore when he's shoving, it's almost always for value because he knows he has a very narrow value range. He's more likely to get called by our hero. Therefore, he's less likely to be bluffing, which makes sense because it's not a great spot to bluff, which I agree with Joe. Initially, I thought it might be a decent spot to bluff, but it isn't because with the line he takes, it looks like he's totally full of shit. And since he's a high-level thinker, and I'm pretty sure he knows our hero's a fairly advanced player too, that it's a terrible spot to bluff. The line just looks bluffy, therefore it shouldn't be a bluff. When it looks bluffy, you shouldn't bluff. When it looks like for value, then that's when you should bluff. Do you guys understand what I'm saying?
Right.
So because of that, Joe said his, you know, it's almost always for value and he would fold. So
the reason fold is I'm assuming this kid doesn't have a second barrel, and if there's a big whale in the game,
yeah, that's the other thing you're talking
about. I can let
go
of my $500 that I lost here and still recoup it against this big fish. So
yeah, that's the table dynamics. You could pass up on this very close EV spot. It might not even be that close and wait for a better spot against a whale in the game. That might be a good enough reason to fold. But anyways, our hero called. Just because, again, he thought, the guy was trying to push him around, and villain showed pocket force for forceful. So, you know, our hero was wrong. So Joe was right.
He's never going to show like anything. He's not going to show King Queen and be like, "Oh, you got me." It's just not. I just never see that at high stake games. Good player against good player.
Yeah. So you're saying it should be a fold, also.
Yeah.
Right?
I said fold, and then.
All
right. I think the whole thing for me is, I agree with you. You know, good player versus good player, it's not going to happen as much. But I think it depends on the dynamic, and I'm operating under, you know. Just thinking back to time, you know, you see someone who's going to step up in stakes. They've never played that stakes before. You know they're shot-taking. You're probably not going to give them credit. While they might be a good player, you're not going to give them credit for being as good of a player as the good players in that game. And, you know, operating under that assumption that he's going to view it that way, I think there will be times where he does make that play.
Yeah. Yeah, I thought it was just an interesting hand, and I thought it could have gone either way. Like, I flip-flopped my answer. Initially, I said call, because I thought, like, some of the hand, he could have, like, ace-king, king-queen with the club he was trying to check-shove the turn with, and when you checked it back, he just decided to bluff it off on the river. But the more I thought about it, the more I agree with Joe. The kid, if he's a very good player, which sounded like he was, he knows that line looks so bluffy, so therefore it can't be a bluff, because very good players know. You value bet when it looks bluffy, and you bluff when it looks like you're going for value. So that's how you make money.
I actually think the most important thing in this hand is actually what Nick said, and just that, you know, it's going to be close. And, you know, why risk this when you have a much better opportunity versus, you know, this whale later in the game, I'm sure. And, you know, it's that there's value to having that money, you know, to still play in that game later on versus bad player, rather than trying to really push a really slight edge, maybe possibly, or even a negative edge against a very good player, if not the best player in the game.
Right. I agree. That's a great point. All right, well, we're out of time, so I want to thank you guys for coming on the show today. Thanks a lot, Dave and Nick. Let's get your Twitter handle so people want to follow you. I know, Dave, you're always tweeting about your games and stuff, how you're running, stuff like that. Nick does the same. You guys are so results-oriented.
Nick Divella, NICKDIVELLA.
And Dave, what's your Twitter handle?
At D. Tannenholz, DTANNENHOLZ.
Okay, and as usual, I'm at Nicolak Poker, NICOLAK Poker, and Joe Tihan is at Joe Tihan, TEHAN. And I forgot to mention, if anyone has any questions, hand histories they want us to dissect for 10 hours straight, like someone mentioned, we can do that. You can always tweet it to us or email us at john@stagmcoaching.com or joe@joetpoker@gmail.com. This was Cash Plays, brought to you by StackemCoaching.com. And again, use promo code QuadJacks82 and get a free 3-day trial and elevate your game. Thanks for listening in, guys. We'll see you guys next time.
See you guys.
See you guys.